parents and students in Dorchester District 2 have been complaining about the lunch that's been served to many students. Today, I talk one-on-one with Dorchester District 2's school board member, Justin Farnsworth, in depth for this edition of Quintin's Close-Ups. And if you haven't already, subscribe to my YouTube channel and like Quintin's Close-Ups on Facebook. Justin Farnsworth, welcome back to Quintin's Close-Ups.
Good morning, sir. How are you?
I'm doing great. It's a different type of Zoom speaker view here, but we'll adjust to it eventually. Let me jump right into it, because obviously, as you know, Dorchester District 2 has been having some issues with the quality of food given to some of the students. And just recently, the Dorchester District 2 board chair says districts switched to food service providers to save money. And this is a headline coming from ABC News 4. And in the article, it reads this: a Sodexo spokesperson, that is, addressed the district board members at a recent board meeting. The spokesperson, that is, said the company is reworking menus and coordinating with vendors to provide successful school lunches for all students. Justin, let me ask you this. Have any of the board members been able to look at this revamped school menu?
So we have. Yeah, I would tell you, Quentin, it's certainly kind of a continuing issue for us. The honest answer is, from a board member perspective, I would tell you, I don't know that we are in the weeds day to day picking out, you know, exact menu items. I don't think that's our job. But I do think our job is to make sure from a high level that we are providing quality, nutritious, affordable meals for all of our students in the district.
And have you been able to taste some of those revamped menu items?
We have. And, you know, what I would tell you, it's interesting. So going with the firm Sodexo that we are using, of course, now for our food services, Sodexo is a multinational. They are a major, major player as far as food management facilities. That said, they are also very in tune. Sodexo is able to come into a community, and I do think it takes some time, but they're able to come into the community and work through some of those menus, for instance, in the Low Country. Some of the things that kids prefer more than others. Hey, listen, a kid is going to prefer pizza and chicken nuggets potentially over, say, broccoli and some green beans or something like that. The tricky part is Sodexo has to do that and fall within the guidelines. There's a lot of USDA guidelines and regulations, and making sure that they're following all of that stuff while also catering a menu to our Low Country students, knowing the types of things that they like.
And I know that over 150 team members obviously packaged 9,000 meals, and they say they're already seeing much improvement. Where are the improvements?
Yeah, I think, again, you look at Sodexo, and maybe let's talk about, I think, what happened a little bit as far as how we got to that place where the food and really wasn't meeting our standards. You know, I think, unfortunately, we look at the world today, the pandemic and the issues that are going on in the world. You know, a lot of the supply chain, so the supply chain logistics, getting the food to the schools, even with Sodexo as a huge provider, they had a lot of trouble getting food, ordering food through that whole supply chain and getting it to the schools. And so that was a big problem. And so I think, you know, what they've done is they've really gone back and worked with their vendors and their food providers to make sure that we're really getting the right food. And so I think that's where you're seeing the improvement. I think you're seeing better supply chain, the logistics, everything for ordering that food. I think Sodexo is doing a much better job now in the recent weeks than potentially what they originally were doing a few weeks ago.
And what is the right food?
That's a good question. That's the million-dollar question. You know, again, I think when we look at our meal programs in the district, when we talk about the right food, and again, you know, to be very clear and honest, there are a whole lot of regulations. There's a lot of legal stuff that goes on behind the scenes as far as what we have to provide for our meals. You know, you look at the whole triangle of food, and you have to have a dairy and a meat and a protein, you know, different things like that. And so, again, we've got to make sure we meet those regulations. But on the flip side, we've also got to provide food that the kids are going to eat, because we don't want a lot of waste. You know, again, from our standpoint, and granted, right now, all of our meals are free. You know, so I will put that out there through the federal government and some different programs they've got in place. We are able to provide all of our meals for free. So that's breakfast as well as lunch for our students. But when we're not in that kind of free status, we also have to make sure that our food is affordable. And again, we've got to make sure the kids want to eat in our cafeterias, because it is, you know, it operates as a business. Our food services operate as a business. And so we've got to make sure that the kids are engaged and purchasing our breakfast and lunch to help that business run.
And as a matter of fact, Dorchester District 2 hired a food service company, Sodexo, to provide meals for students, schools that is, as a way to save money, according to board chair Tanya Robinson. How much money is the school district saving with Sodexo?
Yeah, so, you know, what I would tell you, and some of that gets into contractual issues, but Sodexo did come into the district. We were able to work out, again, those contractual issues, and they essentially have a guaranteed savings that they're able to provide to the district. I would tell you on an annual basis, we're looking at probably $1 million, if not more, on an annual basis, just from having Sodexo on board. Again, I think you look at a company like Sodexo, huge, huge, huge multinational company, their economy of scale, the way that they're able to order food and provide food around the world, really kind of drives those savings. I think they're very efficient as far as their, again, their food services, their personnel model, how they serve food, all that sort of stuff comes into play. And again, I think they do a great job in helping us make sure those costs are low.
And what is their personnel model that you know of?
Well, and I will tell you specifically for Dorchester District 2, it was very important when we started the discussions, and this was months ago, you know, earlier in the summer, when we started the discussion to even look at bringing in an outside food vendor, the most important piece and the piece that we would not budge on was the fact that Sodexo would give the option and retain every single one of our employees, every single one of our DD2 cafeteria and food service employees that we had within the district. We required Sodexo to offer those folks a job, to offer them the same job, if not a better job, within their organization in our district. Again, that was of the utmost importance to the board and to our district leadership, because we have a lot of folks in our food service group. They've been there for a long time, and we wanted to make sure and take care of them as best we could. So again, their personnel, I didn't mean to cut you off, but their personnel model very much revolves around what we already had in place, but then also taking in their experience, again, as that multinational corporation, and understanding how they need to have folks in different positions to make sure everything works. It's a blend of those two things to really give a great personnel experience.
And she says this too, Ms. Robinson, quote, because they can buy things in great bulk, it does make the cost go down for us. How many food items have they bought in bulk for Dorchester District 2?
Well, I would tell you pretty much everything. You know, the honest answer is, again, and that goes back to the economy of scale that Sodexo is able to order from. You know, when Sodexo is placing a food order, they're not just placing it for Dorchester District 2. They've got multiple other districts in South Carolina. They've got a ton of colleges and universities in South Carolina. They've got hundreds, if not thousands, of different organizations that they're ordering from across the nation. And so when they place those bulk orders, Dorchester District 2 benefits because we are a part of that order. Therefore, the overall cost of that food and that order goes down.
And obviously Channel 4 says this, quote, despite concerns from parents over the quality of recent meals, Robinson says she does not believe Dorchester District 2 compromise in quality when it hires Sodexo. She says this, quote, we don't want to shortchange our children, but we want to be frugal with taxpayer money, especially in our district. Ms. Robinson goes on to say this, quote, we're second from the bottom with receiving funds. So anywhere we can cut costs, but not cut the quality. So yes, we want to do that. Let me ask you this too, Justin. How many funds is the school district actually receiving right now?
Well, and so what I would tell you, we look at it from a budgeting perspective, right? So we budget out certain dollars every year towards our food service. You know, going back to what I said earlier, as far as our food service goes, with Sodexo, in theory, we're able to save upwards of $1 million a year just by using Sodexo. But again, looking at it, our food service, you know, within the district, it runs as a business. So we've got to look at money coming in, i.e. people buying breakfasts and lunch versus money going out. So all the expenses, paying our folks, paying for the food, there's a lot to it. So again, it runs just like a business. And so we budget out every year to run that business within the district.
And let me get to the other side. Sodexo provided a statement to Channel 4, and it reads in this part, Sodexo has been working closely with the supplier and monitoring food shipments to ensure we have enough and to correct the types of foods available for Dorchester students, both those attending classes and in person and those attending virtual school and still relying on us to buy lunch. We are actively working to get more of those types of food students to tell us they like while meeting the requirements and standards of the school district. This includes, as you mentioned, adapting the menu to highlight more locally favorite comfort foods such as pizza, cheeseburgers, spaghettis, and chicken nuggets. They talk about the virtual school students. What exactly is the lunch for them and breakfast as well?
Well, and what I would tell you for our virtual students and students using our remote learning, we are still offering. So, and again, this really goes as part of the world today, as part of the pandemic and what's going on. Through different federal programs, we are able to offer essentially food pickup. So breakfast and lunch items for our kids in those scenarios. So virtual learning as well as remote learning, because right now we are in a hybrid situation where our children are going to school 2 days a week. And then the other days they're remote learning, they're e-learning from home. Right. And so those kids have the ability to go. We've got, I believe it's either 6 or 7 different sites set up throughout the district, different schools right now that provide food to those students. So, you know, so a student or a parent is able to go to that site and then pick up food for that day, pick up meals for that day.
And what is the popular site right now?
Say that one more time, Quintin.
And what's that popular site right now?
The popular site?
Yes, sir, for the pickup.
They're all at capacity. I would tell you, we're getting hundreds of students every single day. Wow. Through those 6 or 7 sites. And again, those are strategically located throughout the district. So we've got them on different ends of Dorchester and you know, the county to make it easy for folks, it easy for them to go and grab that food.
And I want to reread that statement that they provided to Channel 4. They basically said, hey, listen, Sodexo has been working closely with the supplier and monitoring food shipments to ensure we have enough and correct type of foods available for Dorchester students. Who exactly is the supplier?
Yeah, so it's a good question. I would tell you Sodexo, again, huge multinational company. I know I've said that a few times.
No worries.
But they certainly have hundreds, if not thousands, of vendors that they work with. And those are up and down the board. You know, certainly I would tell you from a farming perspective, they've got local and national farmers that they work with. They've got grocers that they work with. But again, just any business out there that's providing food, if you will. You know, you think about chicken and meat and vegetables and breakfast items and cereal, anything you think about food wise, Sodexo has relationships with all of those vendors, working with them to bring that food in through their channels and then to our district.
And I know this might be a repetitive question because I know you probably answered it, but how does the district actually monitor those food shipments?
Well, and here's what I tell you, the honest answer, Quint, when we contract out with Sodexo, you know, we've got a fully written out signed contract with them. And what that really does is it puts a lot of our trust. We trust Sodexo to do what they know how to do. They are, quote unquote, the experts in food service. And so, again, that contract allows us, not to be funny or have a pun, but to take that off of our plate. We let Sodexo work with all of our food service. And that really lets the district do what we know how to do, and that's educate kids. So that's our number one job, and our priority is to educate kids. We let Sodexo handle all that other stuff. And, you know, every once in a while, we do hear about the issues, the stuff that came up a couple weeks ago. We hear about issues and very quickly have to adapt and address those issues with that contractual partner, Sodexo.
And how long did it take the district to adapt and address this?
I would tell you almost immediately. You know, we found out very early on. Unfortunately, we did. We saw some pictures and some different messages coming in. And I would say within I would almost say minutes, you know, hours, we were on the phone with Sodexo leadership. They've got a leadership team here on the ground in the district that's always here. So we were in touch with that group.
Okay.
And then very quickly, I would tell you, Sodexo was really phenomenal because they've got folks all around the world. They brought in folks from around our region and as well as from around the nation. They actually flew people in and from a leadership perspective to tackle these issues. And so very quickly, they jumped on board. And we were very impressed with their overall response to make this issue better.
That is great to hear. You mentioned during this entire conversation about hybrid model, obviously, that you all are adjusting to right now. Mm-hmm. What kinks are you still working out right now as we speak?
Yeah, I just from a high level, it's certainly not ideal. And I don't think anybody would say that it is ideal. You know, from a learning perspective, from an educational perspective, I told you earlier, our number one goal is to educate our kids. We want to give our kids an education that's up to the standard of Dorchester District 2. I think when you look at that, I would say that every single board member, every single district person, every single district leadership person knows and we feel that normal school, kind of 5 days a week, in-person classroom learning is really the best avenue that we know of to teach our kids. So we all want to get to that place as soon as we can, but we've also got to make sure that we do that with safety and health and those different things in mind. And so that's why right now we're in this hybrid model, you know, to allow for social distancing, to allow for sanitizing of our schools and our classrooms when the kids are not there. But again, you know, there are certainly challenges. Listen, just like you and I on the Zoom call and trying to get all the technology pieces correct. Right. you think about that for a classroom of 30 kids, you know, that's difficult. There are certainly challenges with technology, making sure your kids are all there, getting work turned in, keeping students engaged, I think is a big one. We've got to make sure that we keep our students engaged, even though they're working from home. How do we do that? So there are certainly challenges, but I would tell you, Dorchester District 2, we've got the best team on the planet. Our folks are amazing, and we're working through it. We're making it work. We're addressing those challenges.
And obviously, you talk about right now being in the hybrid model. What logistics are you looking at to move to the next model?
Yeah, so you know what I would tell you, the plan that we laid out, so the district laid out a plan a few months ago,
right.
And our plan is based on DHEC metrics. So South Carolina DHEC provides metrics and numbers as far as the pandemic. And so that's the main driver. We're looking for number of cases, incident rate, that sort of thing. And what DHEC essentially reports to us that it is safe for us to get back in our schools 5 days a week, that's how we're going to proceed. But I would tell you that the district is always looking at, and one of the conversations we have a lot is to make sure that we are providing the best education that we can for every single one of our children. That's really, really, really important. And so again, from a high level, we've got the plan laid out. I think it's a good plan. It's logical, and we're moving forward with that plan based on DHEC metrics. But if there are any ways that our district leadership or our board can provide education to more, to a better education to more of our students within that plan, and we can do it with safety and health in mind, then I think you'll see some of those options come out.
And you talk about DHEC. Let me ask you this, Justin. Any cases right now in Dorchester District 2?
Yeah, from a DHEC perspective. And so DHEC reports every week. So they have weekly numbers that they come out with as far as the pandemic, and that is county specific. Right. You know, and it's interesting because we did, I would say from the Labor Day weekend, the long weekend, we don't really know. We did see a little bit of a spike in the numbers as far as, you know, the COVID numbers for our county. It came back down. And then this past week, our incidence rate actually went up a good bit. So, you know, it's just a matter of watching the numbers. You know, again, I think DHEC, they're the medical experts. And we've really put we've hung our hat saying, listen, we know how to educate kids. You tell us really when it's safe to put them back in the classrooms, and we'll follow that guidance.
And that incident rate, where exactly did it spike in your mind? Which area of Dorchester District 2?
That's a great question. I wish I could tell you. You know, of course, when it comes to that, the health stuff and the reporting, I don't know exactly. And some of that, you know, the confidentiality and that sort of thing. Right. But it is countywide, you know, so DHEC looks at it from all the way at the upper end of our county, which is St. George, all the way down through Somerville. You know, looking at it, I think you look just at a demographic perspective. Certainly Somerville proper, the town of Somerville is where the majority of our folks live, work, eat, and play. So my guess would be you would see the numbers increase in that area, particularly inside the town. But again, I don't know. I don't want to say that because I just don't know for sure. But it is the entire Dorchester County as a whole that they look at.
Justin Farnsworth, thank you so much for your time. And again, absolutely, welcome back to Quintin's Close-Ups.
You got it, Quentin. Always good to talk with you, sir. I'm here if you need me.
Oh, yes, sir. I'll definitely check you out again.